panda, 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 panda. I got broads in Atlanta, switch it to me in the family. Credit cards in the scammers, hitting the licks in the van. Legacies. So hello guys, it's me again, Von and Rizzy Galit, and I'm here today for another video of the summary of CCNA NetAcad Chapter 5. Ethernet encapsulation. Ethernet is the most widely used LAN technology today. Ethernet operates in the data link layer and the physical layer. It is a family of network technology that are defined in the IEEE 802.2 and 802.3 standards. Ethernet supports data bandwidth of 10 Mbps, 100 Mbps, 1000 Mbps or 1 gig, 10,000 Mbps or 10 gigs or and 40,000 Mbps or 40 gigs and 100,000 Mbps, 100 gigs. LCC sublayer. The Ethernet LCC sublayer handles the communication between the upper layers and the lower layers. This is typically between the networking software and the device hardware. The LCC sublayer takes the network protocol data, which is typically an IPv4 packet, and adds control information to help deliver the packet to the destination node. The LCC is used to communicate with the upper layers of the application and transition the packets to the lower layers delivery. MAC sublayer. MAC constitute the lower sublayer of the data link layer. MAC is implemented by hardware, typically in the computer and IC. The specifics are listed in the IEEE 802.3 standard. MAC sublayer. As shown in this figure, the Ethernet MAC sublayer has two primary responsibilities: the data encapsulation and media access control. Data encapsulation. The data encapsulation process includes frames of assembly before transmission and frames disassembly upon reception of a frame. In the forming the frame, the MAC layer adds a header and trailer to the network layer PDU. The data encapsulation provides three primary functions: frame delimiting, addressing, and error detection. Frame delimiting, the framing process provides important delimiters that are used to identify a group of bits that make a frame. These delimiting bits provide synchronization between the transmitting and receiving nodes. Next one, addressing. The encapsulation process contains the layer 3 PDU and also provides for detailing layer addressing. Error detection. Each frame contains a trailer used to detect any errors in transmission. The use of frames aids in the transmission of bits as they are placed on the media and in the grouping of bits at the receiving node. Media access control. The second responsibility of MAC sublayer is media access control. Media access control is responsible for the replacement of frames on the media and the removal of frames from the media. As its name implies, it controls access to the media. This sublayer communicates directly with the physical layer. Ethernet two frame fields. Preamble and start frames delimiter fields. The preamble 7 bytes and start frame delimiter, or SFD, also called as the start of frame 1 byte. Fields are used for synchronization between the sending and receiving device. The first 8 bytes of the frame are used to get the attention of the receiving nodes. Essentially, the first few bytes tell the receivers to get ready to receive a new frame. Destination MAC address field. The 6-byte field is the identifier for the intended recipient. As you will recall, this address is used by layer 2 to assist device and determining in a frame is addresses to them. The address in the frame is compared to the MAC addresses in the device. If there is a match, the device accepts the frame can be unicast, multicast, or broadcast address. Source MAC address. This 6-byte field identifies the frame originating NIC or interface must be unicast address. Ether type field. This 2-byte field identifies the upper layer protocol encapsulated in the internet frame. Common values are in the hexadecimal 0 times 800 for IPv4 and 0x86DD for IPv6 and 0x806 for ARP. Data field. This field contains the encapsulated data from a higher layer, which is generic layer 3 PDU or more commonly an IPv4 packet. All frames must be least of 64 bytes long. If a small packet encapsulated, additional bits called a pad are used to increase the size of the frame to this minimum size. Frame check sequence field. The frame check sequence field is used to detect errors in frames. It uses a cyclic redundancy check. The sending device includes the result of CRC in the FCS field of the frame. The receiving device receives the frame and generates a CRC to look for errors. If the calculation match no error occurred, calculation that do not match are indication that the data has changed. Therefore, the frame is dropped. A change in the data could be the result of a disruption of the electrical signals that represents the bit. MAC address and hexadecimal. An Ethernet MAC address is 48-bit binary values expressed as 12 hexadecimal digits or 4 bits per hexadecimal digits. Just as a decimal is a base 10 number system, a hexadecimal is base in 16 system. The basic 16 number system uses the numbers 0 to 9 and the letters A to F in this figure. Shows the equivalent decimal and hexadecimal values for binary 000 to 111. It's easier to express a value as a single hexadecimal digit than as 4 binary bits. Representing hexadecimal values. Hexadecimal is usually represented in text by the value preceded by 0x, for example, 0x73 or a subscript 16. Less commonly, it may have followed by an h, for example, 73h. However, because of subscript text is not recognized in command line programming environments, the technical representation of hexadecimal preceded with 0x. Therefore, the examples above would be shown as 0 times 08 and 0 times 73 respectively. Hexadecimal conversion. The numbers conversion between decimal and hexadecimal values is straightforward, but quickly dividing or multiplying by 16 is not always convenient. If such conversion are required, it is usually easier to convert the decimal or hexadecimal value to binary, and then to convert the binary value to either decimal or hexadecimal as appropriate. The Ethernet MAC address structure. MAC address structure. The MAC address value is direct result of IEEE enforced rules for vendors to ensure globally unique addresses for each Ethernet device. The rules established by IEEE requires any vendors that sells Ethernet device to register with IEEE. The IEEE assigned the vendor a 3-byte 24-bit code called the organizationally unique identifier. IEEE requires a vendor to follow two simple rules as shown in this figure. All MAC address assigned to NIC or other Ethernet device must use that vendor's assigned OUI as the first 3 bytes. All MAC address with the same OUI must be assigned a unique value in the last 3 bytes. Unicast MAC address. A unicast MAC address is the unique address used when a frame is sent from a single transmitting device to a single destination device. In the example shown in the animation, a host with IPv4 address 192.168.1.5 or source requests a web page from the server at IPv4 unicast address 192.168.1.200. For a unicast packet to be sent and received, a destination IP address must be in the IP packet header. A corresponding destination MAC address must also be present in the Ethernet frame header. The IP address MAC, the IP and the MAC address combine to deliver the data to one specific destination host. Broadcast MAC address. A broadcast packet contains a destination IPv4 address that has all ones in the host portion. This numbering in the address means that all hosts on the local network broadcast domain will receive and process the packet, meaning network protocols such as DHCP and ARP use broadcast. As shown in this animation, the source host sends an IPv4 broadcast packet to all devices on its network. The IPv4 destination address is the broadcast address 192.168.1.255 when the IPv4 broadcast packet encapsulated in the Ethernet frame, the destination of MAC address is the broadcast MAC address of FFFFFF in hexadecimal. Switch fundamentals. A layer 2 Ethernet switch uses MAC addresses to make forwarding decision. It is completely unaware of the protocol being carried in the data portion of the frame, such as an IPv4 packet. The switch makes its forwarding decision based only on the layer 2 Ethernet address. Unlike legacy Ethernet hubs that repeats bits out all ports except the incoming ports, an Ethernet switch consults a MAC address table to make a forwarding decision for each frame. In the figure, the 4-port switch was just powered on. It has not yet learned the MAC addresses for the 4 attached PCs. Learning MAC address. The switch dynamically builds the MAC address table by examining the source MAC address of the frames received on a port. The switch forwards frames by searching for a match between the destination MAC address in the frame and an entry in the MAC address table. The following process is performed on every Ethernet frames that enter switch. Examining the source MAC address. Every frame that enters a switch is checked for new information to learn. It does by examining the frame source MAC address and port number where the frame entered the switch. If the source MAC address does not exist, it is added to a table along with the incoming port in this figure. PCA is sending an Ethernet frame to PCD. The switch adds the MAC address for PCA to the table. If the source MAC address does not exist, the switch updates the refresh timer for the entry. By default, most Ethernet switches keep an entry in the table for 5 minutes. Examining the destination MAC address. Next, if the destination MAC address is a unicast address, the switch will look for a match between the destination MAC address of the table frame and entry in its MAC address table. If the destination MAC address is in the table, it will forward the frame same out the specified port. If the destination MAC address is not in the table, the switch will forward the frame out all ports except the incoming ports. This is known as unknown unicast. As this figure, the switch does not have the destination MAC address in its table for PCD, so it sends the frame out all ports except in port 1. Frame forwarding methods on Cisco switch. Store and forward. A store and forward switch receives the entire frame and computes the CRC. If the CRC is valid, the switch looks up the destination address, which determines the outgoing interface. The frame is then forwarded out the correct port. Cut-through. A cut-through switch forwards the frame before it is entirely received at the minimum. The destination address of the frame must be read before the frame can be forwarded. Cut-through switching. In cut-through switching, the switch acts upon the data as soon as it is received, even if the transmission is not complete. The switch buffers just enough of the frame to read the destination MAC address so that it can determine to which port to forward the data. The destination MAC address is located in the 6 bytes of the frame following the preamble. The switch looks up the destination MAC address in switching table, determines the outgoing interface ports and forwards the frame onto its destination through the designated switch ports. Fast forward switching. A fast forward switch offers the lowest level of latency. Fast forward switching immediately forwards a packet after reading the destination address because last forward switching starts forwarding before the entire packet has been received. There may be times when packets are relayed with errors. Fragment-free switching. In a fragment-free switching, the switch stores the first 64 bits of the frame before forwarding. Fragment-free switching can be viewed as a compromise between store and forward switching and fast forward switching. The reason fragment free switching stores only the first 64 bytes of the frame is that most network errors and collision occur during the first 64 bytes. Memory buffering on switches. Host-based and shared memory buffering. Host-based memory and port-based memory buffering frames are stored in QUICs that are linked to specific incoming and outgoing ports. Shared memory. Shared memory buffering deposits all frames into common memory buffer, which all the ports on the switch share. Duplex and speed set settings. Two of the most basic settings on switch are the bandwidth and duplex settings for each individual switch ports. It is critically that the duplex and bandwidth settings match between the switch port and the connected device such as a computer or another switch. There are two types of duplex settings used for communication on Ethernet network, half duplex and full duplex. Both ends of the connection can send and receive. Half duplex. Only one end of the connection can send at a time. Destination of same network. There are two primary addresses assigned to a device on Ethernet LAN. Physical address, the MAC address, used for Ethernet NIC to Ethernet NIC communication on the same network. Logical address, the IP address used to send the packet from the original source to final destination. IP address are used to identify the address of the original source and the final destination. The destination IP address may be on the same IP network as the source or may be on a remote network. Introduction to ARP. Recall that every device with an IP address on the Ethernet network also an Ethernet MAC address. When a device sends an Ethernet frame, it contains two addresses. Destination MAC address and source MAC address. The MAC address of the Ethernet NIC, which will be either the MAC address of the final destination device on the router. Source MAC address, the MAC address of the sender Ethernet NIC. To determine the destination MAC address, the device uses ARP. ARP provides two basic functions, which is resolving IPv4 addresses to MAC addresses, maintain a table of mapping, removing entries from an ARP table. For each device, an ARP cache timer removes ARP entries that have not been used for a specified period of time. The time differs depending on the device operating system. For example, some Windows operating systems store ARP cache entries for 2 minutes as shown in this figure. Commands may also be used to manually remove all or the entries in the ARP table after an entry has been removed. The process for sending ARP requests and receiving an ARP reply must occur again to enter the map in the ARP table. So that's all for today, guys. That's all for summary of chapter 5 in NetAcad CCNA. I hope you like it, guys. I got bribes in Atlanta, switch it to me in the family, credit cards in the scammers, hitting the licks in the van, legacies.